Okay, I think we're going to start our next session. So we have a very interesting panel measuring human rights. We have Meg Satterthwaite, who's here at NYU faculty and director of Center for Human Rights and Global Justice and the Human Rights Institute. Erika George, who's a professor from Utah, who's writing a book. This is part of a book. And Nikki Reisch, who's the legal director of Center for Human Rights and Global Justice and one of our NYU alum. And actually, her talk is the only one that we're not going to tape. I'm just reminding whoever's taping. But hers is not quite yet a paper, but a beginning of a project that is related to the work that the Human Rights Clinic has been doing, that she's been working on. So without further ado, I think we'll go in order unless you have objections. Meg?
So I would like to thank the organizers of the conference. Is it up there?
Yes.
The PowerPoint? Okay, awesome. For allowing me to be part of this conference. So I'm in an interesting position because normally I'm extremely critical, and most of the things I've written about human rights indicators are extremely critical. This particular piece is trying to be a little bit more appreciative, maybe is a way to say it. So we'll see how that goes. So what I'm specifically doing is looking at a set of data sets in particular, sets of indicators that look at what are called physical integrity rights. So it comes out of a larger project. I was going to write a book. I was writing a book, but it was too big and too long. So I've basically just been chopping it into pieces. This highlighted piece is the piece I'm going to be talking about right now. So these are just kind of some domains of where human rights indicators have been utilized, created, constructed, marketed, et cetera. And so I'm specifically going to be looking at these standards-based measures, which is what they're called in the literature, where folks are using them to look at physical integrity rights. So what are they? They're essentially data sets that were designed specifically for large-end studies in political science, economics, and international relations. So they're not for human rights scholars originally. They're really for folks in other fields who want to do large-end studies and use human rights as a dependent variable. So the idea was, well, how can we actually do this systematically? So there was a couple of different efforts to create indicators of human rights, and specifically to be able to use human rights as a dependent variable in relation to things like, you know, really big questions about socioeconomic and development issues. Does democracy promote human rights? Does economic development result in better human rights, et cetera? So at essence, it's turning country-specific qualitative information into indicators using a standardized scale. And you're transforming heterogeneous qualitative data into a homogeneous quantitative format. What qualitative data are we talking about? And that's what I'm going to be talking about. So the examples here are Freedom House's civil and political liberty scales, the political terror scale, and then the Cingrinelli and Richards Human Rights Data Project. And I will be talking about the second two. So the political terror scale is a data set that has, and I'm saying data set because it's actually a data set of indicators in a downloadable format that you can then run regressions on. That's the whole purpose of it. So this is the standard or the standardized scale that the political terror scale uses, and I'll talk a little bit more about it, but I just wanted you to be able to see it. As you can see, it's an ordinal scale, 1 to 5, and it's meant to capture physical integrity rights as enjoyed or not enjoyed in practice. This is the Siri human rights data sets. Well, as you can see, the asterisk ones are from the Physical Integrity Rights Index. So this data set is actually a series of data sets, and I'll talk a little bit about this in a minute, but one of the main indices within it is the Physical Integrity Rights Index. Okay, so there are some commonly acknowledged problems with these measures, and I'm not going to focus on those, but I just want to mention them. The first is national aggregation. So they're all, the basic unit is a country year, so it's a national indicator for 1 year. So there will be one rank for each country for each year. And so obviously there's no subnational disaggregation. There's no disaggregation along the lines of various, you know, subnational groups, ethnicity, sex, et cetera. And then the issue of variance truncation is sort of obvious on the face of it. If you have only five levels, or in some cases three or four levels, you're going to have very large differences among countries that are going to be mushed down into small differences on the scale. But the point of this was, when we actually look at the qualitative data that's being coded, the feeling is it cannot be made more precise than these large chunks, and that that actually would be false precision. So the sources are, oh, I forgot to turn my timer on. Are you going to give me a, okay. The sources are the U.S. Department of State country reports and the Amnesty International annual report. Not their country reports, their annual report. Okay, so those of you who know human rights reporting know that those are very particular types of reports. Now, why did they use those? Why did scholars start coding those instead of some other things? Essentially because they wanted a real-time series, and they wanted a set of reports that were relatively systematic as they could get for this kind of qualitative data, and go back as far as possible in time. So a lot of folks talk about it as good as we can get for that purpose. So the question I have is that really true? And I'm trying to be fair. So from the perspective of human rights law and practice, as a human rights lawyer, because I teach a clinic, so I think a lot about practice and kind of what we do in our work, how is the fit? So one of the things I do in the paper is just briefly go over the development of these sources, because I think they're relevant to understanding what's being coded. So the U.S. Department of State country reports started back in the mid-70s, and they were meant to be an objective assessment mechanism in order to determine whether countries had engaged in, quote, consistent pattern of gross violation of internationally recognized human rights for statutory purposes. So this was the genesis of the Department of State reports. The genre of the human rights report had not come into existence yet, and of course now, given that there's been a lot of recent historical attention to the development of the human rights movement, the mid-70s is, you know, many people would now say is the beginning. Others would at least say it's a key moment in the development of the human rights movement. And it's certainly early years. So the early years of the Department of State reports, there was a big concern about political bias, you know, more critique being brought down on, our non-allies, I'll just say. And then the lack of transparent guidelines. So at first there weren't even really guidelines for how these Department of State reports should be prepared that were made public. The methods were unclear. So again, it was the beginning of human rights investigation, human rights reporting in general. So the idea of kind of a systematized approach to documenting human rights violations was even something that was very nascent. Sources were obscure in the early days in terms of some obvious things that were clear, which would be cases, but then beyond that, in terms of looking for things that we're talking about, like cases of torture, political imprisonment, et cetera, where countries are not only not going to be publishing the data, they're going to be falsifying it, lying about it, hiding it, et cetera. But at the same time, these reports also tended to rely on the same sources as large human rights NGOs. And actually, many human rights NGOs were the sources for the country reports. So there was like a little bit of circularity there as well. The Amnesty International annual report is really interesting. And for this paper, I went back and looked at every annual report starting in 1962. Mm-hmm. And having been on the Amnesty board, it was extremely interesting for me to do that. The first report published in 61, you know, it really was not an annual report until the mid-70s, which is, you can really see why these standards-based measures started then. Between 62 and the 70s, the annual report was actually a report on what Amnesty was doing. So it would be, you know, this country, this group in London met and, you know, wrote some letters, and they did some research, and then it started to get more systematic over time. So in 1966, they only talked about 15 countries. 75, they're up to 107, 77, 116. So you can see also the scope of the report was expanding. The substantive focus began just saying, here's what amnesty is doing. Then they started to systematically try to talk about the situation of political prisoners in as many countries as they could cover. And then they started really to encompass the human rights situation in countries in relation to their mandate at the time, political imprisonment, torture, cruel and human degrading treatment, disappearances as they emerged, and extrajudicial executions. And then finally, because amnesty's mandate not only evolved, but also then changed over to encompass the full range of human rights, including economic and social rights, there was that broadening of the report as well. So this is kind of the framework for how I think through the analysis in this paper. The first three elements, human rights dimensions, are scope, intensity, and range, and those are the ones that these standards-based measures say that they're measuring. And I add the two on the bottom, systematicity and interdependence, and say that they're actually also kind of encompassing those as well, but not explicitly. So scope in these two sets of measures, and I should say I'm not looking at Freedom House in this paper, in part because at the time that I started doing the research, there was a pretty strong consensus that Freedom House was seen as having been kind of more captured by the Department of State or U.S. government approach than some of the other measures. But I think in the last two or three years, I think there's been kind of a resurgence of Freedom House, which is interesting. So PTS and SERI both explicitly look at the issue of scope as a human rights dimension, and they say that they're really focusing on physical integrity rights. For the political terror scale, there's a list of specific abuses that are then aggregated as they're coded. For SERI, there are specific the types of human rights that are disaggregated. So they're coded on a disaggregated basis, and they have very specific definitions that are based explicitly on human rights law. From a human rights legal perspective, it's interesting because they only tend to cite one source for the coding definition, which is intriguing, I think. Just say, take the definition, take non-refoulement as an example. You'll get a different definition under CAT versus the ICCPR. That's not really engaged with, but it's certainly much more legally maybe grounded than the PTS definition. So just a couple of interesting discrepancies. With SERI, there's a very strong focus on state-sponsored or state-instigated human rights violations. So the definition and the type of attribution used in the coding handbook, I argue, is under-inclusive in relation to human rights law. And then the political terror scale has an over-inclusive issue when it looks at all, it actually includes all killings of civilians in combat as human rights violations. We know that's not actually true under humanitarian law and human rights law. Not every killing of a civilian would be a human rights violation. So a couple of interesting practice points from the perspective of the annual report. For amnesty, over time, there was a desire to try to go from couple countries to try to cover the whole globe. And so there was an attempt to include what they called minimum adequate coverage in their annual report. That went back down to strategic coverage, and then it went more to kind of a campaigning format. So you kind of see, I don't want to do a distribution here, but you kind of see an increase to kind of trying to cover the whole world and then back down a little bit where amnesty kind of accepts that it can't do that. And domestic violence is an interesting example. In the annual reports, they will start to try to have they'll try to address whatever issue they're campaigning on that year. So as an artifact of coding, you could sort of see perhaps that there would be a spike in certain kinds of abuses because suddenly they occur in every country. That's obviously a problem if it's true. I have not tested it empirically. In 1991, Amnesty explicitly started addressing human rights violations by non-state actors. So that's another interesting potential effect that you might have in the coding. The Department of State similarly had been critiqued very strongly for failing to attribute certain death squad activities to states, and again, that may have an impact on what was included in the coding. So looking at intensity in SERI, and I know I have to go, oh my gosh, 1 minute went from 5 to 1 really quickly. Okay, so let's see. Intensity, I will just say one interesting thing here. So Siri, I think, is pretty straightforward. They have these definitions disaggregated, and then they also include these quantitative benchmarks, which I think are really, really interesting, because you don't find numbers in these reports very much, and there's an extremely interesting internal debate about whether to put numbers into amnesty reports and also whether to put numbers into the Department of State reports. But there are these quantitative benchmarks. PTS, fascinatingly, has, and I won't go over because I don't have time, obviously, but this is kind of a, I've tried to create a schematic for how they describe the coding, and I have more to say in the paper about that, which I won't say now. The range issue, I think I've already kind of gone over. That has a little bit to do with the types of populations that they're addressing. And one thing to say here is that there are some serious discrepancies from a human rights perspective, legal perspective. For example, the Siri does not include non-citizens, which I think is really very, very striking. And they also don't include extraterritorial abuses. So systematicity is a really significant issue for human rights reporting. It's something that human rights organizations are very, very strongly attuned to. But it's not addressed explicitly, but implicitly, which I don't have time to go into. Interdependence, again, is really interesting. I showed you that matrix for PTS. Basically, the rights are kind of they're through the coding process, they're interdependent, but not in the way that human rights people would think about. And with Siri, interestingly, the disaggregated scores are simply added. There's just a summative approach, which is very interesting. What about perverse interdependence? I won't go into. To close, I guess the question one might have is, like, why did I do this? Am I saying that, you know, these standards-based measures should be more like human rights law? Am I saying that human rights law should be more that human rights reporting should be more reliable so that it could be systematically coded? I think what I'm trying to say is that there should be more of a dialogue both ways. So in particular, I think that just from the perspective of coding, that these data sets might value reliability over validity, but then they could also say back that perhaps human rights folks value validity over reliability, in the sense that we have not, and this is a different agenda from another project of mine, but we have perhaps not articulated our methods very well in the human rights investigation, documentation, community. And so I would say that we actually can learn some really good lessons coming back the other way as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Meg. Sorry for being militant.
Okay. Good afternoon. I, too, would like to thank the organizers. And I really do appreciate the opportunity to share this work and to engage with the indicators community. I'm a relative newcomer to it. And the work I'll be presenting is part of a larger project that is interested in the problem of corporate accountability. So I'm going to talk to you about the problem I'm interested in addressing, the purpose of the broad project that I'm working on, and then go to the central points that I think indicators can help illuminate. So I'm interested in the problem, as several people are, of a global governance gap that's arguably given rise to a space where transnational corporations or multinational enterprises can place human rights at risk. There's either regulatory reluctance on the part of a home state that is trying to attract trying to export investment and have those companies be competitive, and host states that are trying to attract investment. So to take an example that's often cited early in the literature, the case of Shell in Nigeria in the Niger Delta, the government at the time unwilling to enforce or adopt environmental protections or human rights protest protections, and the results were human rights violations where environmental activists are executed. Or more recently in the Democratic Republic of Congo, allegations that the minerals mined from that region contribute to ongoing conflict. So to interrupt this problem or to close or bridge this regulatory gap, there are various strategies. The one in ascendance now is a voluntary code of conduct either at the level of corporations or at the global level in the form of a UN framework and guiding principles. The alternative would be, and it's happening now this week, negotiations to have a binding instrument that would regulate corporate actors. So I'm interested not only in what can close the gap, but how it can be closed. And I think indicators can be part of that bridging process. So for this paper, which is a chapter in a book that argues that the regulatory gap can be closed not necessarily by binding law, but by soft law that becomes strong, is looking at indicators, rankings, and reports, kind of broad trends and what's emerging on the part of non-state actors, NGOs, in entering this area as self-help regulators. So unlike, I think, many in the room who are skeptical about indicators and are concerned and find them challenging, I think there's a tremendous opportunity here that human rights activists are beginning to realize they can use as they're crafting different indicators. So my main points are that indicators and rankings are regulatory tools and they can serve as guides for us. I'm doing field work in this area that's primarily participant observer, going to UN meetings and meeting with NGOs and interviewing the people who are part of creating these rankings and indicators. I mean, my preliminary findings, and these aren't indicators that have yet been released, I'll go through six of them. Is that there's more coordination and collaboration among the people producing them than there is competition, that the subjects of the indicators, the transnational corporate enterprises and particular industry sectors, actually are where the contestation is coming through competition. They're trying to outrank one another or make sure they're not at the bottom of the list. And then finally, that there are counter strategies that corporations could come up with are complicated by legitimacy and perceptions of self-reporting versus the outside third-party independent or advocacy-oriented NGO. And then I'll close with some methodological and moral risks of ranking rights, and I think this may go to Melissa John's point earlier about why maybe lawyers aren't as cooperative with efforts to do the counting, because human rights lawyers I've interviewed have actually been somewhat hostile to it. So. By way of introduction, I used as my operative term the term and definition of indicators given by Professor Davis and Kingsbury and Mary, looking for areas in the human rights movement where we were engaged in rank ordering, name sets of data, simplifying complex phenomenon where there's a human rights put at risk, and then projecting into past performance of a corporate actor and looking forward in ways that these become authoritative. So I'm interested in consistency, transparency, authority, and impartiality, and the extent to which NGOs are able to leverage these as they create indicators. Why the move to try to measure? In 2001, the UN Human Rights Council endorsed unanimously the UN framework on business, enterprises, and human rights. This came after a five-year process. Professor John Ruggie of Harvard's Public School of Government was appointed by Kofi Annan in 2005 to just investigate the problem of transnational corporate actors and human rights violations. This came after a sordid political process and the demise of a soft law, what would have emerged to be a binding treaty discussion, being put to the side and put in place instead a framework that just gave three operating principles to try to address where corporations thought they weren't liable, were liable, and what the solutions would be. And Professor Ruggie came up with a framework that essentially said states have the obligation to protect human rights, that you can't offload to corporate actors that responsibility, but what you can say is that corporations at minimum have a responsibility to respect human rights. And then finally, there should be right to an access to remedy. So the activity now has been happening in the last few years around giving content to the meaning of what it is to respect human rights. What is a corporate obligation to respect human rights, and what does that look like? So we now have a what, but we don't really have a how. The framework was put into a series of principles, and those have only been around for the last few years. And what we do know at minimum is that responsibility to respect human rights means you avoid creating an adverse impact and you address the impacts that you have if they are adverse. But how do we know if they're yours? So enter NGOs and collectives of them coming up with ways to create ways of measuring compliance with that responsibility to respect, and others that are concerned about a particular industry sector. So I'm going to talk about a few. In the paper, I've gone through several, but they divide into three distinct categories. There's one set of groups that are more professionalized and keyed to the development of indicators around the UN Global Framework Standard. There are those that are more activists that take a particular issue or industry sector and rank companies within that industry sector. And then finally, there are others that are actually closely tied to the investor community, which I find most interesting and I think will probably have the most salience because they have a demand, arguably. So the first two I'll talk about, one is the Corporate Human Rights Benchmark Initiative. This is an early process and it's a coalition of investors, private investors, some clearly socially responsible investors that are faith-based, like the Calvert funds, and others that are in Europe, and they've come together and they have planned to develop an open source ranking of all corporate human rights performances that would be for an audience of investors and civil society, focusing first on sectors where there have been the most allegations of human rights abuses. So they'll begin with extractives, they'll do apparel, they'll do food and beverage, and the information communications technology sector. They're presently in a process of multi-stakeholder consultation. So this is, again, a departure from the usual have experts and technocrats create something to an inclusive process. The investor is making, I think, determinations, but getting information from a broader set. And their interest, if you read their early methodological literature, is around information, empowerment, leverage, and transparency. Those are terms that come up again and again in the development process. They're actually having meetings in New York later this year, but they're doing it in Johannesburg and London, so they've got major financial capitals participating in these conversations and consultations. So that's the coalition of investors. The next set of professionalized actors that are coming up with a ranking is RAFI. These are people who were previously on the staff of the Special Representative of the Secretary General. So these were folks who helped draft the UN guiding frameworks and the principles. And their ranking is less of a ranking and more of a reporting system. So some of them call themselves ranks, some of them call themselves reporting. But ultimately, they are providing what they're saying is an assurance framework. So they're co-opting some of the language of risk management from business, taking a managerial approach to developing what will be information that arguably could feed the development of indicators later down the road. Again, this is a small group of individuals in a specialized firm as contrasted to in groups of individuals that are in the investor community. Having a similar conversation, but not approaching this through information incentives and transparency, but rather kind of a corporate social responsibility frame of business ethics and we can do better. So more of a friendly rhetoric towards the business community. This is in striking departure from the next category of cases that I've identified. And we start to see more of these as activist NGOs or individuals coming from a human rights movement. So the ranking digital rights framework is the next one. This is really the brainchild of one individual who's since built a coalition around herself, but Rebecca McKinnon used to be a journalist in Beijing around the time that some dissidents were imprisoned after Yahoo, primarily Yahoo, but after U.S. multinationals had given information to Chinese state security forces that led to finding out who sent what email about what democracy NGO. So a lot of people are in prison. So she has come up with a ranking digital rights around expression and privacy indicators. Again, it's still in its methodological phase, working with stakeholders to get design and survey. She's going to collect the information from surveying businesses and NGOs, and she's framing this as guidance to industry to self-educate about the risks and impacts that they will have in operating in different countries. So this is far from a straight NGO rank 'em and spank 'em approach to looking to how industry actors are actually confronting the challenges they have operating in different contexts. So it's purports to be broader. Different still from that are the powerful established NGOs like Oxfam. They have a ranking that's a scorecard. They're starting with the agricultural sector, And they've got Beyond the Brands, where they're ranking the top 10 multinational food brands, from Nestle to Mars to Pepsi. And this is public information. They're researching on their own rather than asking just for savory responses. And their narrative around their scorecard is about social justice, and the audience would be consumers. So they're less concerned about investors as the CBHRs of the RAFI or even the corporate actors, but more mobilizing a political base that's already bought into Oxfam's brand of humanitarian activism. And then finally, the other ranking I've looked at, also more reporting, is at the state law level. California has a transparency regulation that is now requiring companies to report what they're doing to identify human trafficking victims in their supply chain. Up until literally the last 2 months, there was no activity at the State Attorney General's office on this, but Know the Chain, a coalition of 10 different anti-slavery organizations from around the globe, came together and started looking for what these companies were doing. What were they publicly reporting? Was there any information? If there wasn't, they'd send a letter to the company, and then they printed on their website a listing of who is not doing anything about trafficking. They can't represent that there's traffic victims, but what they are doing is listing these are the companies in this industry sector that have a statement and these ones do not. So again, a consumer could conceivably go there and compare. Last month, Kamala Harris and the state's attorney general's office started sending letters apparently to those companies that weren't listed on the NGO list of having complied with the regulation that they weren't looking to see if anybody bothered to comply with. So. The final part of this work for me is trying to make sense of this emerging ranking and reporting, and it still is emerging. It hasn't yet merged. Very few of these are published yet, but the drive towards getting businesses to respect human rights and take it more seriously, I think, has probably more room for success in this arena than any other, in the sense that they're speaking languages of due diligence and risk mitigation and management that industry can understand. Kevin talked earlier about, is this substitution, is this complementarity? They're creating this in coordination with one another. They don't seem to actively want to compete, and in fact, I think coordinate to reference one another's sets of indicators at this early stage. So they're not seeing this as something that's substitutable, and I think this is because there are resource constraints, so why repeat what's being done in another sector? So for example, the RAFI has actually reached out to the Global Reporting Initiative to make sure that what they're doing is consistent with reporting regimes that industry is likely already to have in place to get that data information. I didn't mention the Access to Medicines Initiative. This is another ranking, again, by an individual who happened to care about pharmaceutical, not coming from a human rights background, but from the industry himself. And he's been able to approach this as getting industry to learn from the information they collect to reply to his indicator ranking. He's attributed his success to being able to be cited in the Financial Times. So to the extent that the makers of human rights indicators with access to the information media is used most by the industry sector themselves seem to be getting more salience and traction more quickly. So I've been trying to give some thought to where they get their information, the outcomes they're likely to have, and the interaction and influence they have with other law and policy sectors. At the last UN Forum on Business and Human Rights, this is the successor to John Ruggie's organization, there was an entire panel devoted to the development of indicators. So this is a space that people active in that movement are beginning to watch and beginning to enter into. And I think that some of the things they can learn from what's gone on and is going on with the World Bank doing business indicators could be helpful as they craft and create these instruments. But they're highly normative. There is an agenda behind them. Those behind them are committed to getting business to reform. And I think it's closer, I like to be optimistic, and I think it's closer to getting them anchored in this discussion in a way that they previously hadn't. So to come to an industry actor and say that you're rating and ranking rather than you're being an advocate for human rights is getting audience. So the criticisms and challenges from colleagues in different parts of the human rights community that aren't developing indicators is the worry that it'd be difficult to compare 10 extrajudicial killings with three tortures. I mean, are we doing the kind of work that really lends itself to quantification? I think that a lot of the downfall of human rights advocacy in this arena is it's dismissed as anecdotal, so that to the extent that they can identify and find ways to translate human rights principles into corporate social responsibility rhetoric or something that gets paid attention to and reported on in the general course of business, the better off we'd be in mainstreaming this movement. So,
thank you, Erika.